Unfortunately, she's not able to be here today. Elizabeth said, well, I can just introduce myself. But I said, nah, feature speakers should have someone to introduce them. So I said, let me, as department chair, take on that responsibility. Dr. Lieber's comment also said, everyone knows who I am. Well, yes, I think we do know. But just as a reminder, Dr. Lieber received a PhD from the University of Otago in New Zealand. Is it Otago or Otago? Otago, University of Otago. She came here in 2007 as assistant professor and was promoted to associate professor in 2013. She has published in some very prestigious journals, including Milton Studies. For those of you who don't know, anyone who gets anything published in Milton Studies needs to be given a hearty congratulations, most definitely. In any case, I'm not going to tell you a lot about her presentation, although that was given to me, a little blurb was given to me, because I think she will probably take care of most of that herself. Let me just say that we're fortunate to have someone of Dr. Liebert's qualifications and her enthusiasm and her involvement both as a teacher, as a researcher, and as someone who gives boatloads of service to the university here with us. So I will turn the time over to Dr. Liebert.
So I know that those of you who are from the sciences are used to a presentation style that is a lot more informal. Those of us who are from the humanities and particularly literary studies, when we give a presentation, we usually read a paper. And because I'm going to be sharing with you some new translations of poetry, I'm going to be doing a lot of reading. So I perhaps apologize for that ahead of time. I want to begin with some really brief introductions. First of all, the poet that I'm going to be talking about today, Vasij Kalkali, was a 20th century Turkish poet living in Iran and writing in Farsi. He's not known in the West because his works have not been translated into any other languages. So the project that I have been engaged in is the first such project to take Vasij's poetry and translate it. Vasij visited the United States in 1995 looking for a translator for this particular work, The Woodcutter's Epic. He didn't find a translator, but our own Dr. Peterson made it his life's mission to ensure that this work would be translated. And it took him 20 years before he located my co-translator, who wishes not to have me mention him. And he, in turn, recruited me. And my co-translator is fluent in Farsi, so he does the first level of translation. Then we sit down and we talk about every line of poetry again, and sometimes every word, and sometimes the nuances of the word, what they, the connotations in the original and possible connotations in English. And then my task is to produce the blank verse translation. The original Farsi is written in Masnavi, which are lines of 11 syllables, and they rhyme. As English readers, we find rhyme perhaps somewhat frivolous. If we think about things like Dr. Seuss, there's an example of a rhymed story, and we find it hard to take rhyme as seriously as English speakers used to. So we decided to use blank verse as a medium that is traditional, that has strict formal expectations, and that still preserves perhaps some of the dignity and the weight of the original. And just in case you don't know what blank verse, I think everybody here does, it's the iambic pentameter line that's not rhymed. So lines go da-da, 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 da-da. Five repetitions of the unstressed stressed syllable in a line. So, enough introductions. A few weeks ago when I was starting to prepare for this presentation, I opened a National Geographic because I was intrigued by a title, Self-Proclaimed Messiahs, which struck me as somewhat oxymoronic. How can a messiah be self-proclaimed? And my response to that article made me go back to the Messiah story and think about the structural elements that are in that story that might have to be reproduced in another work of literature in order to suggest that this work of literature is messianic. And I came up with 10. I don't know why 10. And of course, it immediately made me think of Joseph Campbell and the 10 stages of the hero's journey. So we have, and it'd be nice if we had a remote, but we don't. Oh, sorry, we should have had this going before. What is going on? Okay, I see. The animations were done by my son, by the way. He was helping with the presentation. I did modify some a little bit. So I have 10 stages of the messianic journey instead of the hero's journey. All right, thanks. The first is prophecy, that the advent of the Messiah is it's prophesied, it fulfills long-standing expectations of a captive or a suffering people. The second one, the devout mother, or virginal if possible. The virgin birth is obviously central to the mainstream Christian understanding of the Messiah story, but perhaps equally important to the story is the fact she's not just a virgin, she's devout. She doesn't question beyond perhaps questioning her fact that she's appropriate to bear the Messiah. The portentous birth, there are a lot of supernatural events or unusual events that accumulate around the birth of the Messiah. The star, the visit of the shepherds, the angels in the sky, the wise men. And these all help to establish the authenticity of the Messiah. And those of you who know the life of Brian will remember how important these are to really establish the authenticity. You don't want to give those gifts to the wrong baby. Extraordinary childhood. The Messiah demonstrates precocious maturity, wisdom, and faith. And then scenes of recognition. And these include scenes of recognition by the Messiah himself. He becomes aware that he has a destiny. And scenes of recognition by others. And there are one or two events in Jesus' childhood where he's at the temple and you realize that he's something special. Divine approval and appointment. In the story of Jesus, of course, there is the divine voice after his baptism by St. John saying, "This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased." Suffering. The Messiah suffers himself. Physically and psychologically, the effects of others' enmity, but he also identifies with others' suffering. And this too is prophesied, of course. I think it's Isaiah saying he's a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Then we have the plotting enemies who misunderstand the Messiah's role, feel threatened, and plan to eliminate him. the unmerited betrayal. So the climax of the story isn't actually precipitated by the plotting enemies, but by a trusted friend who's driven by greed and or envy. And then finally, the acceptance of death as necessary. And this conclusion emphasizes the immense sacrifice necessary to redeem the captive people who began the cycle with the prophecy. So this was my analysis of the Messiah story in the Bible. And if we move from that Messiah story to messianic literature, some of these are essential or fundamental, that it can't be a Messiah story unless you have some of these key scenes or these key movements within this story. Prophecy, for instance, I think that's really important. Scenes of recognition. You're not going to be able to establish a Messiah figure in a work of literature unless somebody recognizes him. Suffering, betrayal, and the acceptance of a necessary death, which doesn't actually have to be physical. And then others are secondary, so they might enrich a messianic narrative, but they're not essential. Or they're extraordinary. And the two that I think are extraordinary are the virginal birth, which is sometimes replaced perhaps by an absent mother or a devout mother. And those of you who are familiar with the Dune series would think of Paul Atreides' mother, Jessica, who's a member of the Bene Gesserit. And she's been trained particularly to fulfill the role of bearing a particular child. And then the divine appointment and approval. It's very difficult to have a divine voice speaking in contemporary literature and for the reader to take that seriously. So we'll see what Barsich does with that one as we go through. So when I took this list and I went back to the woodcutter's epic, I found that every stage of the Messiah's journey is included. So that a reader with even a cursory familiarity with the biblical story would find it really hard to avoid identifying Lincoln as a messianic figure. Clearly, it's very important to Basij that his reader understand that Lincoln was to be read not only as a historical figure, but also, and possibly even more importantly, as a symbolic figure. And I've put some of those in bold. Those are the stages that I'm going to look at in today's presentation. Part of the reason for that is that we're only between a third and a half of the way through the translation. It's a massive work. It's 14,000 lines of poetry. And if you've ever tried writing blank verse, a line or two, you'll know that it's not a quick and easy task. So we're still on the way. So what I want to do, and I think we can go to the next slide. And we can just line all of these ones up. I want to share with you, first of all, some passages that exemplify the first six stages on the messianic journey. So this is where I'm going to be doing lots of reading of poetry. And then I want to contextualize this presentation of Lincoln as a Messiah figure within the epic itself. And then lastly, I want to look at the political context in which the poem was written and suggest some readings of the poem that relate to that context. And I think we have a picture here. So if we click again.
I'm still learning how to operate your computer.
That is the most whimsical computer ever created. So this is an illustration from the published book. It was published in 1966. It's only been published once, and this is the original Farsi, and it was illustrated by Muhammad Taibidi. And this picture here is from a poem called At His Mother's Grave. And I should perhaps just point out that Basij calls this an epic, and it is in terms of its scope and its length, but it's not an epic in the traditional Aristotelian sense. It doesn't present one great action and elaborate that with episodes. Rather, what it does is it tells the story of Lincoln's life. So there are some narrative poems, but in between those narrative poems are thematic poems, and they can be located pretty much anywhere in the world at any time, but they relate thematically to the story that Basij is telling. All right, I think we can go on. All right, so first of all, prophecy. I've given you just one poem. It's the last one that I'm going to come to in the first half of this talk. So hopefully you can read along with me. This is taken from a poem called The Last Will. And in this poem, a slave is anticipating his death, and he is giving instructions about what he wants to have written on his tombstone. Now, of course, there's no way that this entire poem could be put onto somebody's tombstone. So he sort of goes off on a bit of a tangent, but near the end of the poem, he starts talking about the advent of the Messiah, somebody who's going to come after his death. And when he comes, that advocate of slaves, and when his wisdom brings us back to life, then kiss his head for me 1,000 times, and smooth a gold comb through his tangled hair. For he will come, once I am dead, a friend, a woodcutter, who'll hew oppression down. He does not care for wealth. The sun of love for all humanity shines in his eyes, and from his birth his soul has sung with ours. When I am dead, life shall bring forth a child whose hands will wipe the tears from slaves' sore eyes, whose file will free the fetters from their feet, and when he comes, their hearts will swell with love. When I am dead, a song will pierce the night and reach the ears of all imprisoned slaves. When I am dead, a remedy will come, and blood will course through their pale cheeks again. Devout of soul, as gentle as Messiah, a man of God, he holds a wondrous scroll. He pours new wine into the thirsting heart, and those who love life cleanse themselves with prayer. When I am dead, when that peacemaker comes, that holy one, and slaves' tongues are untied, then pledge my memory in freedom's wine. Remember me, light my dark loneliness. Embrace his axe, a sacred amulet. Record his thoughts like gospels in gold ink. Tell those slaves whose feet he frees from grief, tell those he rescues from the jail of suffering to consecrate his cavern as a shrine, so peace and freedom sing across the world. And ask the blacksmith in my name, blacksmith, why are you forging chains to bind our feet? Why are you braiding whips to shed our blood? Why are you making swords to pierce our hearts? And of course, with any of these categories, there are a number of poems that I could have chosen to put in. And one of the challenges is what to leave out and then what to include. So we're going to move from there to the portentous birth next, and then to the devout mother, although I presented those stages differently in the introduction. So this is the account of Lincoln's birth. There's not really very much historical basis for it. As far as I'm aware, there's no suggestion historically that Lincoln's birth was difficult. It might have been. There are some historical details. His father is out trying to make a living as a farmer in a rather unthrifty land. So here we have it, just the first 40 lines. The midwife creeps to the corner. The groans of the laboring woman tear night's curtain. Beside her bed, slack, exhausted, a man gnaws his lip between two teeth. Home again from the poor lands where he's been scattering some optimistic seeds. On the road back, that blister on his foot had burst, and as he tore a bandage from his shirt, he vowed that if his wife survived childbed, if death's fatal claws did not close on her flesh, each Saturday he'd get down on his knees and pray the Father's continued blessing. Almighty Lord, who comforts those that hurt, who cures their hidden pains, I ask your help, O Lord, because the fibers of my soul are stretched so bad they're close to breaking point. The midwife racks her brains. Oh, we didn't have that on hand. Oh, sorry about that. I should have looked up there first. She scrambles to recall everything her man had taught her, but still the woman's shrieks grow worse. It seems a hopeless case. She lights a twist of straw and holds it smoking to the woman's face. It doesn't help. The woman's drenched in sweat. Her body shaking and her heart gallops and her distress keeps getting worse. as though she's giving birth to all the suffering the world has known. Her delicate body is gripped by hellish pangs as she struggles to heave that massive bulk into the light, or as though she's laboring with freedom, the hope of slaves that slumbers in time's eyes, as though she's giving birth to all the beast in man, the feral nastiness he's learned. Perhaps the child is dead, the midwife thinks, and lies breech. She doesn't realize that when genius is born, it's as though mountains burst from atoms. The chains that chafe the bones of fettered slaves groan and clatter and groan, afraid the child they've waited for will die, afraid his mother won't survive the agony of birth, afraid the midwife will give up. And this illustration from birth, you can't see it very clearly, but she's lying here, that's his mother, this is father, there's the midwife in the corner, and then later on there are scenes from later in his life, you know, he's got his axe, there are slaves in the background, and here again, I don't think you can see that, but maybe you can when you're further away from it. Yes, you can. There's Christ, right? So all those elements are brought together in the illustration. All right, a devout mother. And perhaps in view of the time, we'll just read one of these. So click again and when it will. Well, I'll just read the first one. At night, the day's toil done, his mother spun him stories so her son would fall asleep. Stories of heroes' intrepidity, fortitude of mighty conquerors, songs about Solomon and Sheba's queen, tales of Christ's healing robe and of the cross on which he sacrificed his life for criminals, of Mary and the disciples' disbelief, of Eve and Adam cast from paradise, of Harut and Barut, of good and ill, and tales about the faithless Nazarenes who barbed the Virgin Mother with their taunts. So it is very simple, but exemplifying the fact that she raised him by telling him stories of religious figures, it was a religious history. Harut and Marut were two angels. The angels thought that humans were very weak and very quick to give in to temptation, and angels wouldn't behave like that, so two of them, Harut and Marut, got turned into people to go down and see how easy it was, not how easy it was to resist temptation, and sure enough, they started behaving like everybody else when they were in their mortal forms. So we might just the second one is from the gypsy fortune teller, which I'll explain in a few moments. But I think we better go on. An extraordinary childhood. There are a number of poems that talk about the little woodcutter. In terms of blank verse, that's a horrible phrase because it breaks the meter, but you know, we just use it anyway. Upon a hill, within a hovel, dark and derelict, and Barsiege suggests a comparison between this log cabin and the stable in which Jesus was born. He makes that appear in another poem. Upon a hill, within a hovel, dark and derelict, far from the city's noise, he waited. As an eagle waits its prey, occasion to emancipate the slaves. Secluded there, the little woodcutter saw his tomorrows painted in his dreams, peopled with bright liberty, her shackles shaken off, her stains of shame erased. He saw the sun rise to his father's throne, the prophet Paul face sacrifice with faith. Twilight to dawn, the little woodcutter drowsed at his mother's side. He seemed to hear her stories, but his soul roamed, and he heard and watched what happened somewhere else. The next poem, an excerpt from a longer poem called Axes and Roots. Again, that messianic significance. He was the world's one hope that veiled until the future offered him his chance. But as he's out there working in the forest, cutting firewood, with each stroke his axe aimed at their roots, 100 plans were running through his head, a plan to cut the roots of slavery, a plan to topple tyranny and wrong, a plan to liberate the captive blacks, that people doomed to cruel servitude, a plan to tear the fetters from their feet, a plan to show the world nobility. So in a sense, this serves not only his extraordinary childhood, but that self-recognition. He understands at a very early age that he has this particular destiny. Now, of course, again, this is ahistorical. Young Lincoln didn't know that he was going to become the 16th President of the United States and sign the Emancipation Declaration. So this is Basij playing with history. And then scenes of recognition. And again, a little bit concerned about the time. So just a few lines here. This is actually based on a historical event. When Lincoln was a teenager, I can't remember if he was 17 or 18, he was working on a riverboat and he went down to New Orleans. This is where he first saw slaves being sold, and he found it repugnant. And the story goes he also visited a fortune teller, and she read his palm and told him that he was going to become president of the United States and emancipate the slaves. Well, you know, it's very easy to tell that story afterwards, isn't it? But we know that Basij had access to biographies of Lincoln. He did read English. And because he was reading biographies that were probably written in the late 19th century, early 20th century, they were perhaps a little bit romanticized. So this is where he goes to visit the gypsy fortune teller as a teenager. And she knows the moment that she looks at his hand that she's seen something unusual. She sees lines on his hand that she has never seen before, and she has read hundreds of palms in her time. So she goes through, as the poem goes, she's like reading the different lines. This broken line segmented in two halves, this shows you've set extraordinary goals. Your eyes are full of love for humankind, your head full of desire to reach your dreams. Cruelty and wrong of all kinds sicken you. You shudder to see boys torment an ant. And here's another line, right where the thumb meets with the wrist, its third joint, we might say. A rare mark. Only the noblest souls have this line. It's God's passport, his special grace. I recollect my mentor telling me, and now, young man, I'm telling you, should you find God's passport on a hand, you must tell that person what it means and who he is. Tell him, resist the world, be true, endure, and life itself will tune her will to yours. So this is one of those moments of recognition where this complete stranger reading his hand knows that he has a particular and very special destiny. And finally, stage six, divine approval and appointment. And this is the poem that I gave you as a handout because this actually contains. I didn't put it up as a slide, so we can just leave that one there.
Okay.
Because I gave it as a handout, it's not on the PowerPoint. It contains many elements of the messianic story, and so I wanted you to read the whole thing. And here's what you should be listening out for. A pen or pencil with you, you can actually underline and take notes, active reading. So first of all, prophecy. Here we have a dream, and there's a focus on the role of the Messiah and how that will alleviate the sufferings of the captive people. We have scenes of recognition, we have self-recognition as Lincoln recognizes his destiny and accepts that, and then the recognition of others. Here, in this case, it's the dreamer. Divine approval and appointment. This is one of the most fascinating moments in this messianic story as it unfolds. Because Basij has chosen to present this as a dream, he can actually have the voice of God speaking. So we get that direct parallel to the divine approval and the appointment of Christ. Suffering, Lincoln suffers because of other sufferings as the Messiah does. And also we have the acceptance of a necessary death. And this is just hinted at by the divine voice. midnight. Swept out to sleep by sorrow's waves. I'd washed my hands of life, bid it farewell, lay in life's coffin like a soulless corpse, all memory of the world wiped clean away. I was a captain shipwrecked by the storm, a straw wind swept along an endless gorge. The day's blood-spattered shirt stuck to my flesh, and chains, my bones' old neighbors. Too weary to wash hands or face, I fixed a makeshift bandage round my gashed arm. Pain ate my soul like fire. Down I dropped on that stone bench next to the corral. Past and future slipped away. Helplessness rode me, and I sought refuge in sleep. I chose oblivion over life. Dreams came, as every night they did, limpid as images on the water's smooth glass. I saw a young man walk the woods alone, his looks threadbare, starved cheeks, deep eyes, head bowed in thought or sorrow. All alone he trod the forest paths, barefoot, bundled billets on his back, a sharp axe in his hand. Grief spilled from his eyes, sprung from compassion's wells. Upon the path, a slave owner abused a slave, lashing him with storms of blows. The victim wept like April showers. Shrieks from his very marrow rose to the skies. His crime? He fell asleep when he should walk, and sometimes fainted, lacked the strength to bear the load. From his heart's depths, he cried, he howled, "Shatter, you spheres, and all your influence. Why vent your furious rage upon us slaves? Why our sworn enemy? You fill our cups with exploitation's poison, and to bless us, knock us down with misery's cudgel. For all your thousand starry eyes, you're blind. I spit upon your face, I curse your soul. The seeds of grief you scatter in life's fields to grow thorns to pierce our blistered feet. You drive your ruinous hail upon us slaves, but bathe our masters in the sweet sun of delight." The young man left, pressed forward, a small, dark cavern. He stacked the firewood on a stone, opened the cavern door, sang through the dark, "No greeting to mother, father, no." He sank into his silent thoughts, much like a diver sinking in the ocean swell. He hid his face in calloused hands, as if he stood before his long-lost sweetheart's grave, as if the world's griefs all took aim at him, as if his soul had been devoured by fire. Me, my sighs can melt a heart of stone, and God's my witness that I sighed for him. He picked a little portrait of Messiah up and gazed into its eyes. His voice rang raw. "Dear Lord, your shed blood ransomed us from sin, and in your name we struggle towards good. But once again man paints his face with blood, he chooses slaughter like a savage beast. Again the deer's blood drips from tiger's claws. Again the wolf patrols the folded lands. Seated again upon the throne of God, dark Ahriman benights the human heart, and man revives barbaric slavery. Again ignorance roots in human souls. Again the leathersmith unceasingly is braiding lashes from the mild cow's hide. Again life's house is echoing with cries. Again the helpless curses rise from jails. Again the orphan child is raised on slaps from his ill-tempered master, not on milk. Again forged chains are regulating life. Again injustice poison fills life's cup. Again the markets teem with human goods who weep while waiting to be sold or hired. Again the powerful oppress the weak, and blood drips from the whip's wounds to their feet. Love is a legend, sympathy a myth. Men don't know love, they find it alien. The story of Harut, though, is revived, and human hearts grow fat with pride and crime. O Lord, empower me, or let me die. loose my constricting bonds, that I loose theirs. Plant your fire of love within my soul, so that my conscience ripens with a crop of sweet kindness. Let its spark sear away my selfishness. Light me the torch of peace, and I will dress man's wounded heart with balm, and I will soothe his sores with salves of joy. The beasts themselves, ashamed by humankind, it wars upon and savages its own. Then suddenly that dark cavern was lit with radiant gold. No candle fed that blaze, and in its glory Jesus' face appeared. The young man cried out at the vision like a lost child gathered in its mother's arms, or like a dead man who's recalled to life. On his shoulders, Jesus placed gentle hands and gazed into his tired, tender eyes. Go, he said. Loose men's feet from ignorance and calm the prisoner's cries that pierce my heart. The lover must be cleansed in his own blood if he would pray, must drive out selfishness if he would break these heavy chains, if he'd have peace and justice governing the world. Go, take your axe, cut through injustice roots. Do as the stonemason did to Mount Bistoon. Forth from the hut the young man came. He saw me standing there. He stroked my hair and with his axe at one blow struck the chains that bound my hands and feet. He freed me from my chains. Sweet Lord, do slaves' dreams too foreshadow truth? And can our shapeless longings take on flesh? A day will come when I see freedom's face and hear the joyous music of progress. A day will come when slaves' dreams too speak true. A day will come when slaves' feet too walk free. A man will come like Christ, who will sacrifice his life for love of humankind, who will ignore all carnal pleasures and desires, who will renounce himself to cherish us. Okay, I am way behind time at this point, which is a bit of a concern, so I'm going to have to start condensing a bit. I think it's fairly clear just from the passages that I've shown you that Barsiege is presenting Lincoln not only as a historical figure and not necessarily primarily as a historical figure, but as a messianic figure, as a symbol. He's given the specific role of liberating Africans from slavery, but his role in the poem isn't limited to that. Barsiege repeatedly observes that the human race is characterized by greed, selfishness, pride, cruelty, and violence, and only the repeated intervention of divinely appointed guides prevents the loss of humanity itself, of those virtues that set us apart from animals, and whose absence result in intellectual and ideological, as well as physical slavery. So these guides are sent by God, and I'm not going to read through this, but what I would like to point out is that many of these guides are founders of world religions. So we have Zoroaster, Socrates, not founder of a world religion, but obviously very, very important to the history of philosophy, the Messiah, Buddha, Muhammad, and I'd just like to read the lines at the end. Into this group of divinely appointed guides, Barsiege places Lincoln. He is the hero. Had man not been directed to faith's path, what would his situation be like now? Had not Messiah cleansed man's sin and blood, had not Muhammad walked this royal road, had not God's light glimmered in human hearts, had no good news descended from above, had not the hero broken slavery's chains, what would man's situation be like now? So in this context, the hero, that is Lincoln, and he becomes one of these seminal figures in the repeated liberation of the human race. Now, if Dr. Peterson were here, he would tell us that Lincoln's legacy is not limited to the emancipation of the slaves. This, of course, is one of the great projects of the International Lincoln Center here on campus, to look at Lincoln's international legacy. But the legacy that Barsiege imagines is different. It actually goes back in time as well as forwards. The poems of the woodcutter take us to a variety of places and a variety of times. To ancient Egypt, for instance, where slaves toiled to build the pyramids, to historical Baghdad, where young girls suffer in the harem, to the world's musicians, not musicians, who knows where that came from, the museums where the artifacts of oppression are displayed and admired, to the slave markets of Samarkand, where an auctioneer talks up his wares. And the these wide-ranging poems emphasize the fact that the suffering of the African slaves is just one example of a far greater theme. And it's really this far greater theme that the epic is concerned with, and that is the repeated, unconscionable violation of human rights. And this is what Lincoln's role addresses. He serves as a model of altruism, and he serves as a symbol of hope for ultimate deliverance for those who have suffered in the past, as well as all who suffer in the present and in the future. And I've put some examples up here from the poem Pyramids. Again, I'm out of time to read these, but I just want to point out that on this side, the slaves who died during the creation of the pyramids are still there. Their souls are trapped under the pyramids, and they're constantly calling out for vengeance. The storks, for instance, in Egypt know that. When they land on the pyramids, they land very, very gently because they don't want to disturb those tormented souls. And in the passage on the right, Basij points out that like Cyrus, who liberated the Hebrews, the woodcutter scoured the nasty taints of shame from history, but with a different agent, his own blood. So Lincoln's death somehow helped to resolve the need of those slaves from Egypt for revenge in some strange fashion. Had he not shattered its chains, the world would be pocked with pyramids. Each city boasts its steeple built of skulls, tyrants guzzled human blood. So it wasn't for Lincoln, apparently, there'd be pyramids everywhere, probably in Shreveport too. All right, moving on in a real hurry. So that's the context within the poem. The real world politics are very, very interesting. The woodcutter isn't just a story about a great leader who lived long ago and in a country at the other side of the world. And it's very important to remember that for Basij, America was a country at the other side of the world. It wasn't here and it wasn't home. It's also a reflection on contemporary social and political ideologies as they become tyrannical, advancing by violating the rights of the individual. And you know, I can read any of these poems too, and it immediately has a contemporary relevance. So the poem is timeless, but as well as speaking to our era and our political and social experiences, I think it also spoke very specifically to the political and social experiences that Basij had in the 1950s in Iran, and particularly to the interference of the British and the Americans in Iranian sovereignty. I'd like to really, really condense history. In 1953, there was a coup in Iran against the democratically elected Prime Minister Mossadegh. This was actually driven by the CIA and by British agents, and in 2013, CIA documents were, what's the technical word for it? Declassified, there we go, declassified, and it became apparent to what extent this coup had actually been driven by the Americans and the British, because they didn't want to lose control over the oil monopolies. Mossadegh was trying to nationalize the oil industry so that the revenue would come to Iran, and the British and Americans didn't want that. So in terms of the way it spoke to its immediate audience, the first evidence that this had something profoundly political, say, to its immediate audience is that Although the epic isn't known in Iran today, one poem is, because it was borrowed by a contemporary singer, a young man called Hassan Shojai. He set it to music, it became an instant success. Right, so this was a like number one hit in the 1960s. The poem is called The Postman, and in that poem, a slave questions repeatedly why the postman hasn't brought his letter of emancipation yet. So I think this was seen by contemporary Iranians as an expression of their frustration and their desire for emancipation as well. Secondly, this poem was proposed three times for a Nobel nomination. It was the proposals, and I have them, and I was going to scan them in, but I didn't remember to do it. They carried the names of the chancellors of the University of Tehran. So these are letters sent by the chancellor of the University of Tehran. There are three different ones in three different years. The proposal was unsuccessful, and in one of the letters, the point is made that, quote, very few members of the academy understand Persian. Perhaps the fact that Basit was here in 1995 looking for a translator speaks to that fact, that he wanted this work to be able to be moved forward, but it couldn't because of the language it was in. And the third relates to that, and this becomes very, very interesting. During my research, I contacted the British Iranian history, Christopher de Balaig. I'm not sure if I'm saying his name correctly, but a very well-known historian. He is a British Iranian historian. I simply asked if he'd heard anything about Basit or his political affiliations. He said he hadn't, but he would send my inquiry on, and he sent me then two responses via email, and we can have these come up now. The first, and these are from friends who are pretty well informed. First one, I have never heard of him and checked with several learned friends, they hadn't either. Have searched a bit about him and read his poetry. It is quite lowbrow and simplistic. I couldn't find any serious reference to him other than a naive interview in Koshi, an arts magazine in the 60s. And then after that, all he's telling us is information that the International Lincoln Center here put on WordPress. So this is not really a very well-informed source. He's just telling us what we already know and we made public. The second one is even more interesting. He was very little known in the 1960s, and the idea that he had been put forward for the Nobel Prize is ludicrous, and that by a university with which he had no connection. I expect it is too late by now to disabuse the translators of the significance of the work and the poet. Again, it's somewhat difficult to prove that claim is ludicrous when it actually happened and we have the correspondence between the chancellor of the university and the Nobel Prize Committee. So what's going on here? I'm not sure, but I think it is perhaps a sense of uncertainty about the political ramifications of this work. I think that at the heart of the woodcutter, there is a deep political message about interactions between East and West, about the subversive and underhand colonialism that great nations practice while outwardly proclaiming liberty, and about the continued need for liberators, perhaps not only in the Middle East, but also in the apparently democratic West. And I'm going to stop at that point. There is one other poem that I thought I might finish with, but this is Basij's grave and the transcript of From the Grave, translated by my co-translator, who does not wish to be mentioned because he's too embarrassed. That was a very abrupt finish. I apologize for that. Do you have any questions?
Alex. First of all, let me thank you for the wonderful presentation. I'm having translated myself quite a few works. It always sounds rough, but yours, my God, it's very flowing and nice, and I can only imagine how beautiful it is in the original Farsi. Can you tell us a little bit about the author himself? So I see that he was born in 1918, died in 95, but what exactly was his career? So he was born, I assume, in Turkey. You said he was from Turkish or ancestry?
Yes, he was born in Khalkhal, Azerbaijan. He moved to Tehran. He traveled himself. I interviewed his daughter and his widow, but she has He raised the money to travel by. He raised, I think it was the cow, sold the cow with the money. He took himself over the mountains to Tehran by himself as a teenager, on foot. He joined literary circles there. He found work with the Ministry of Health. He had very good penmanship, and so he was employed in a secretarial position. Although he was obviously had associations with the University of Tehran, at least they were familiar with his work, he didn't have a degree from the university. He was politically active by writing. One of the slides I had to skip over, he started a newspaper in 1951 with the, I think it was called National Honor. So it was a nationalistic newspaper, very much sympathetic to the ideas of Moscow. The people of Kalkal actually chose him as a parliamentary representative about this time, but the convention was that the Shah would nominate somebody and the Shah nominated somebody else, one of his relatives. So he wasn't given that position, but he was, he had associations with the Shah and the Shah's regime, and that he was asked to go and read poetry at public events. And then in the 70s, and I'm struggling for the dates, it was 70 to 73, it was just before the revolution, he was a member of parliament for 3 years representing
And then after the revolution?
Like all other members of the parliament, he was dismissed. There were a lot of trials for corruption at that point, but he was one of the very few non-corrupt politicians. He had not profited at all from that position. His concern genuinely was that the people back in Kalkar. So he entered retirement at that point.
Did he become an expatriate?
No. No. He lived all his life in Iran and died there.
Now I assume he was a Muslim or
yeah.
That is a very difficult question to answer. I mean, he was culturally, he was a Muslim, but he's very open-minded, and in another work that we've translated called God on Trial, which is the story of the creation of the world and the fall of Satan, his representation of God is very, very close to a Christian representation of God, and particularly his representation of Jesus. He's technically Muslim, but more kind of humanitarian.
From what you have read, the symbology was mostly what I would call Christian symbology.
Yes,
right?
Yes. Any other questions?
Yes. I noticed the use of an animal, particularly slave trade, attempting to market. I counted very briefly something around 16 times.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask, to what extent was that used in the original Pharisee as well? Was it simply repetitious words again, this is happening, again, this is happening?
Absolutely. That's there in the original. Some of the poems are structured around this repetition, so there'll be a series of lines that simply begin with the same phrase over and over and over again.
In terms of the books or the poems itself, the impact. So, as I understand, after revolution, essentially, it's forgotten piece, right? And that they don't even consider it of any value, right? But when it was published, right, so 66, 65, 66, you mentioned. Do we have any evidence of the response to it within Iran?
I don't know. And that's something I would love to find out. My access to information, because of course I don't speak Farsi, is very limited. So, the poet's family is helpful, and I think that Dr. Peterson may well have materials. I mean, I didn't have the letters, the correspondence about the Nobel Prize until I actually specifically questioned him and challenged him, saying, is there any evidence for this? And then he gave me the letters. So I'm not quite sure. I do know that when he died, Radio Free America, is that the right term? Had a program about him at his death as a tribute. So he must have had some kind of reputation, but I don't know the extent of the reputation.
I would tell that many people in Iran, we have aspired all throughout the recorded history to get to where for human rights, social and political justice, equality for all. You know, they have always aspired to get there, and unfortunately, have not achieved it.
Well,
so I'm sure that he had a large population, a fan of him and his work.
That may be related. So you have a hard copy of the book, right?
There is one copy.
Yeah.
It's obviously, you know, fairly rare.
Usually the books mention what was the circulation, the number of copies they published. Do they have any kind of technical information on it? Like the, like in Georgia, for example, Georgia's next door from Iran. Every time a book is published, they say, we published it in 1,000 copies. So this will might give you an idea of the impact of the book or the spread of the accessibility of it.
Doesn't seem to.
Judging from the illustrations, they invested a lot of money in this, right?
Yes,
it was not just
this is published with a grant from the Ministry of Oil and Petroleum.
Mm-hmm.
And this, the illustrator is a very well-known illustrator, and actually considered this as some of his best work. It doesn't seem to be anything at all indicating there's just the title and the author's name, and then the copyright.
It's really interesting to juxtapose the value of the book and how much money and effort they put in it to the emails that we receive from those people saying, oh, he's just worthless.
Yes. Well, this is what makes me suspicious.
Yeah.
You know, why say something's worthless? Why say maybe it'd be a good idea if the translators picked another project? You know, it's just ludicrous. He
yeah.
never would have been nominated for a Nobel Prize. Well, time is moving on. I think we're actually past 12. I have a master's defense to go to. Thank you all for coming. I hope you enjoyed it. I may want to